Welcome to the class. Today we shall start new topic, steam turbines. As you can see here, in Rankine cycle there will be a turbine. In the boiler, water will be converted into steam. That steam will enter into the nozzle. The function of the nozzle is it converts the pressure energy into kinetic energy. After passing through the nozzle, at high velocity of the steam will enter into the turbine. You can see in this figure, the steam will hit the turbine blades. This turbine will place on the rotor. This is the rotor. That rotor will be connected to the generator so that power will be generated. Okay, this is the use of the turbine. In the turbine, steam will expand isentropically. Okay, you will see in detail in the coming slide. Today we are going to discuss principle of operations, advantages of steam turbine, and classification of steam turbines. Before discussing about steam turbine, let us know history. Actually, in early 18th century, steam engine was the first device which was used to convert heat energy into useful work. This was the first device before steam turbine. It was used to convert the heat energy into useful work. As you can see in this figure, this is the schematic diagram of the steam engine. It is almost same as our petrol engine or diesel engine. Here also there will be a cylinder, piston, connecting rod and crank. Okay. Once steam enters inside the cylinder, the piston will, there will be a reciprocating motion of the piston that will be converted into the rotary motion. Okay, here there will be a rotor, it will be connected to the generator. Okay, but here it will give only maximum 20% efficiency. And also some limitations are there. So later they developed steam turbine. Now let us discuss steam turbine. Here we are going to consider two cases. This is the case one. This one is the case two. In case one, as you can see here, this is the blade, turbine blade, which is fixed. Fixed means it will not move. When steam with velocity V1 passing over the turbine blade and leaving the with the velocity V2, since there is a change in the direction of velocity, there will be a momentum. So this momentum exert force on the blade. So that is the force F. Due to the change in the velocity, there will be force exert on the blade. That force is F. Now coming to case 2, here the blade is, turbine blade is moving blade, which means it is moving. Here also, when steam with velocity V1 entering and passing over the turbine blade and leaving the blade with the velocity V2, since there is a change in the velocity direction, the force will exert on the turbine blade. Okay, but here the blade is moving blade, so the blade will rotate. So that the velocity of the blade is u. Again, I'm repeating here. In the case 2, the blade is moving blade. The steam with the velocity v1 entering and passing over the turbine blade and leaving the blade with velocity v2. Since there is a change in the direction of velocity, there will be force exerted on the blade. When force exerted on the blade will rotate because it is a moving blade. When blade rotates, assume that the blade velocity is u. Okay. Now, the total work is force into u. Here F is the force exerted on the blade, u is the velocity of the blade. Okay, the work equals to F into u. And here conditions are, if v1 equals to u, there will be no work. Because if both are equal, there will be no work. And also, if u increases, u means velocity of the blade. If the u increases, obviously there will be increase in the work. Okay, these are the conditions. And also, if u equals to 0, definitely work will also be 0. These things we know. Now, if you draw a common graph between force, work and u by v ratio, here you can see when u by v ratio is 0, here the force is maximum. When u by v ratio is 1, the force is 0. Okay, and also the relation between work and u by v. If you look at here, when u by v ratio increases, the work will increase up to certain level, after that it will decrease. Okay, so here the range, it will be the ratio, it will be 0.5. okay, why it is 0.5 we will discuss in further classes, but here just understand that when u by v ratio increases, the work will increase up to certain level, after that it will decrease. Okay, now let us see the working of steam turbine. As you can see in this figure, it will have a rotor or rotating shaft on which blades are fixed axially as well as circumferentially. Here you can see the blades are fixed circumferentially and also blades will be fixed axially. In this figure you can see clearly this is the rotating shaft or rotor on which blades are fixed circumferentially and also axially along the axis of the shaft. Now coming to working, in this figure you can see the steam from the boiler will enter into the nozzle. In the nozzle, kinetic and potential energy will be converted into kinetic energy and it will increase the velocity of the steam. That high velocity steam will hit the turbine blades so that the turbine will rotate. This turbine is placed on the rotor. This rotor will be connected to the generator so that generator will give electricity. So this is the working of the steam turbine. Now let us see advantages of steam turbine over steam engine. In previous slide, we have discussed steam engine. Now let us see the advantages of steam turbine. The first advantage is here there is no reciprocating mass because it is a dynamic motion. There is no reciprocating motion in the steam turbine. And no sliding members because in steam turbine there is no piston cylinder arrangement. The important thing is the reciprocating engine speed limit is 300 rpm, but here in case of steam turbine we can go up to 40,000 rpm. As we know that W equals to F into U. U is the velocity of the blade. Okay, so once the velocity increases, the work output will be increased. So for steam turbine, the velocity is around 40,000 rpm, so that it will give very high work output. And it does not require any lubrication in the steam turbine because it does not have any piston cylinder arrangement. Of course, lubrication is required, but when compared to steam engine, here it is very less. The more important point is in steam turbine, the efficiency is 60%, whereas in steam engine, it will be less than 20%, almost 40% efficiency is higher in the steam turbine. So these are the advantages of the steam turbine. So nowadays in almost all power plants, steam turbines are using to produce a power. Now classification of steam turbines based on type of blades and blades arrangement, working principle. Steam turbines are classified into several types, but the main types are impulse turbine and reaction turbine. In impulse turbine, pressure drop takes place only in the nozzle and there is no pressure drop during passage over the blade, which means, as you can see in this figure, the steam from the nozzle, it is entering into the turbine, that will hit the turbine blade so that the turbine will rotate. In case of impulse turbine, there is a pressure drop in the nozzle and no pressure drop in the passage over the blade. That is, the type of turbine is called impulse turbine. In case of reaction turbine, pressure drop takes place inside the nozzle and also as well as through the blade passage. Here also there will be pressure drop. This type of turbine is called reaction turbine. Okay, again I'm telling, in impulse turbine pressure drop takes place only in the nozzle, which means here in case of reaction turbine pressure drop takes place in the nozzle as well as through the passage of the blade. The other classification of steam turbine is based on direction of flow. Here there are three types: axial flow turbine, radial flow turbine and tangential flow turbine. In axial flow turbine, direction of flow of steam is in the axis of the rotor. As you can see in this figure, so this is the rotor. The direction of the flow will be along the axis of the rotor, which is called axial flow turbine. The second type is radial flow turbine. Here movement of steam is radial direction, which means here you can see the steam will move radially, as you can see in this figure, so which is called radial flow turbine. The other type, third one, is tangential flow turbine. In tangential flow turbine, steam strike the blade in tangential direction, which means, say for example, this is the blade. Okay, here steam hits the turbine blade tangentially. So this type of turbine is called tangential flow turbine. Now let us move on to other type of turbine based on steam pressure. Here again two types are there: single pressure turbine, dual pressure turbine. In single pressure turbine, as you can see in this figure, this is the schematic of the turbine. Here steam entering into the turbine at point 1 and leaving the turbine at point 2 at particular pressure, that is single pressure turbine. Whereas in case of dual pressure turbine, here you can see in this figure, here instead of having entry at one pressure, entry of steam at different pressures, which means here you can see steam entering into the turbine, say some pressure P1 at point 1, and also entering the turbine at pressure P2. Here steam is entering at different pressures into the turbine. So this type of turbine is called dual pressure turbine, because here pressures are different. The next type of classification is means of heat supply. Here mainly two types, reheating and regenerative. These things we already know. Again, I'm recollecting. In reheating, as you can see, this is the schematic of the reheating cycle. This is the boiler. In the boiler, the water will be converted into steam. That steam will enter into the high pressure turbine. After passing through the high pressure turbine, instead of going to the condenser, it will go to the reheat section, where steam will be reheated, and that steam will send to the low pressure turbine. This is what happening in the reheat. This type of turbine is called reheating turbine. The next type is regenerative. In this case, this is the boiler. From the boiler, the steam will enter into the high pressure turbine. Okay. After passing through the high pressure turbine, after expansion through the high pressure turbine, before entering into the low pressure turbine, some amount of steam trapped that will be sent to the open feed water heater. Okay, the use of open feed water heater is it will preheat the water before entering into the boiler, so that the energy required to convert water into steam will be reduced. So this type is called regenerative turbine. The other classification is based on heat rejected. Here different types are there. First one is pass out or extraction turbine. Here, as you can see in this figure, this is the schematic of the turbine. At point 1, the steam entering into the turbine, and at point 2, steam leaving the turbine after expanding through the turbine. In case of pass out or extraction turbine, before expansion, at intermediate place, at some place, some amount of steam extracted, and that will be used for processes. It may be used in some industries. So this type is called passed out or extraction turbine, because here we are extracting the heat in the intermediate place. The next type is regenerative turbine. This we already discussed. The other type is condensation turbine. Condensing turbine means our regular cycle. In Rankine cycle, there will be a boiler. From the boiler, it will enter into the turbine. From the turbine, it will enter into the condenser. From the condenser, there will be a pump. From the pump, it will enter into the boiler. So this is the Rankine cycle. Since after expanding through the turbine, it is going to the condenser, that type of turbine is called condensing turbine. The last type is back pressure turbine. Here, at the exit of the turbine, steam extended up to lowest possible, which means after expanding through the turbine, say for example here, at point 2 in this figure, after expanding through the turbine at point 2, still it will have a some energy. The steam will be having a some energy. That energy will be fully used for some other purposes. For example, it will be used in the sugar industries. In sugar industries, at low pressure, very low pressure, this industry will be operated. So this is the example for back pressure turbine. Now the other classification is based on number of turbines. As we know that steam can expand in multiple turbines, not only in single turbine, it can expand in multiple turbines. As you can see in this figure, it is a reheat cycle. Here steam is expanding in two turbines, high pressure turbine and low pressure turbine. Okay, if the pressure is less than 500 kilopascal, those turbines are called low pressure turbines. Moreover, by visual inspection itself, we can say which is high pressure turbine, which is low pressure turbine. Generally, the size of the high pressure turbine is smaller and the size of the low pressure turbine is bigger, because in case of high pressure turbine, the specific volume of steam is less, so this size is smaller, whereas in low pressure turbine, specific volume of steam increases, so the size of the low pressure turbine is higher. Okay, so this is the reason why the size of the high pressure turbine is smaller when compared to the size of the low pressure turbine. The other classification is based on flow of turbine. This is the last classification I would like to discuss. Here two types are there, single flow turbine, double flow turbine. In single flow turbine, as you can see in this figure, the steam is entering at point 1 and leaving the turbine at point 2. This is single flow turbine. Whereas in double flow turbine, here you can see it is a combination of two turbines. So it would be like this. Here you can see this is one turbine. This one is other turbine. Okay, here steam will enter at the middle of the turbine and it will be divided in both sides, right side and left side. This type of flow is called double flow turbine, because flow is dividing in two ways,